Here.
Toman.
Here.
Gale.
Here.
Guzikowski.
Here. Everybody, please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. And could our librarian, Jill Lineger, lead us?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item number three, approval of the minutes of 7/17/18 and back a ways. Everybody's had a chance to review them. If there's any omissions or corrections, and when you're satisfied, motion please.
Guzikowski make a motion to approve the minutes of 7/17/18.
Loricle second.
Roll call.
Alderman Loric.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Guzikowski.
Aye.
Kerkowski.
Aye.
Item number four is a council proclamation for Kevin Archambault for his dedicated service to the city as a member of the Oak Creek Celebrations Commission. And Catherine, when you're ready, if you'd read that into the record, please.
Certainly. Council proclamation number 18-09 to Kevin Archambault for dedicated service to the city of Oak Creek as a member of the Celebrations Commission. Whereas Kevin Archambault, who was appointed to the Celebrations Commission in March 2012 and has served for 6 years. And whereas Kevin Archambault has resigned from the Celebrations Commission effective August 2018. And whereas Kevin Archambault took the reins and was instrumental in organizing the yearly 4th of July celebration. And whereas Kevin Archambault joyfully participated in the Easter egg hunt, summer solstice, and the Giving Tree event. And whereas Kevin Archambault, always willing to lend a hand, fulfilled the duties of the Celebration Commission with the greatest devotion and pride. And whereas Kevin Archambault has served the city in a thorough and conscientious and professional manner. Now therefore be it resolved that the Mayor and Common Council of the City of Oak Creek do hereby show their appreciation and gratitude to Kevin Archambault for his dedicated service to the City of Oak Creek as a member of the Celebrations Commission. Be it further resolved that this proclamation be spread upon the minutes of this meeting and that the City Clerk be and she is hereby directed to transmit a suitable copy thereof to Kevin Archambault, introduced and adopted the 6th day of August, 2018.
Thank you, Catherine. Any comments from council for Kevin?
Yeah, Mayor Dan, I have some comments. What are not included in the proclamation about Kevin, the Celebrations Commission and the Oak Creek Community Center, we partnered on quite a few programs as well, programs that benefit and really were fun for the community. And Kevin helped, and I can't even remember, Sharon Armstrong, you're out there, the number of years he helped us with the annual Christmas tree lighting program, and we started the summer concert series, I think it was 15 years ago. Now, that would have made Kevin about 12 at the time, so, or close, you know, he was a youngster back then, but yeah, certainly I think from his beginnings with the city street department, he was always there to help us with programming at the community center, and Ted, thanks for making Kevin available. National Night Out, is that on here as well? A big part of that, so he will be deeply missed, and really, he provided a heck of a lot of volunteer services that made things easy for many of us in the community. So, Kev, thanks.
Great. Anyone else?
Rich, you nailed that song.
Okay. I'm just going to add, I'm at just about every Celebrations thing, too. Kevin played an intricate role, not only on Celebrations, on the events they had, and he raised the bar on what they had existing, but he also helped create new events in the city over the last few years. And, again, his service is greatly appreciated to the city, and all city residents benefited from what he did. He put his 4th of July's aside to benefit the city with the parade and everything else. So, again, thank you very much, Kevin, for your time, your dedication, your service, and your skill. So, thank you. Our first public hearing is... Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, we need a motion on that to make it official for him. If not, he's not getting it. Motion, please.
Dukniak move to approve Council Proclamation number 18-09... to Kevin Archambault for dedicated service to the City of Oak Creek as a member of the Celebrations Commission.
Oracle second.
Roll call.
Alderman Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Guzikowski.
Aye.
Kerkowski.
Aye.
Loric.
Aye.
Our first public hearing, item number five, is consideration to rezone properties at 7781 and 7811 South 12th Street to be rezoned from RS3 single family to B4 highway business, and also a portion of 7869 South 13th to be B4 from institutional I-1. We have Carrie with us tonight. Carrie?
So there is a typo. Everything is on 13th Street, not 12th Street.
Thank you.
The properties that are in red on the screen. The proposal is to rezone 7781 and 7811 South 13th Street to B4 highway business, and a portion of 7869 South 13th Street, which is lot 2 of a proposed CSM that was presented to council, to I-1 institutional.
Catherine?
Public hearing number one is to consider a request by John Thompson, Highgate LLC, to rezone the properties at 7781 and 7811 South 13th Street to be rezoned from RS3 single family residential to B4 highway business, and a portion of 7869 South 13th Street from B4 highway business to I-1 institutional. The applicant is John Thompson, Highgate LLC. Property owner is Dennis and Susan Cieslik, Highgate LLC. There follows the legal description. Date of notice is July 11th, 2017.
Thank you, Catherine.
Sure.
And as Catherine said, it is a public notice, and right after a commentary, we will make three calls. Carrie?
Lot 2, which is on the CSM on your screen, is the one that is being proposed for I-1 Institutional District. This is in advance of a request for a hospital use on that property. Existing parcels in the immediate area are zoned for residential, commercial, and institutional uses, and within 1,000 feet are manufacturing and park uses. The proposal is consistent with the B4 purpose statement. The parcels are also located along a county highway route, which is 13th Street. They're adjacent to the larger parcel, which is along I-94, which again is consistent with the B4 purpose statement. Considering the consolidation via CSM and plans for the development of a commercial PUD on the property, which is forthcoming, the proposal appears to be consistent with the B4 purpose statement. I-1 is intended to eliminate the ambiguity of maintaining in unrelated use districts areas which are under public-related or private ownership, and where the use for public purpose is anticipated to be permanent. Uses permitted shall generally serve the public benefit. So these appear to be also consistent with the I-1 purpose statement for Lot 2, which is to be developed with a medical use. If the council also considers this to be appropriate, there is a recommendation for council to adopt Ordinance 2908 to approve the rezone of the properties. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Carrie. Again, we will open up this public hearing. This will be the first call. Anybody wishing to speak? This is the second call. Anybody wishing to speak, please approach the podium. Give your name and address. Third and final call. Anybody wishing to speak on item 5? We'll now close the public hearing and move on to item 6, which is consideration of an ordinance to rezone the properties we just spoke of. We'll open it up. Council, any questions, comments? Steve.
Mayor, I have, just for the record, I have not had any phone calls from anybody along this route. Most of them lately have been with regards to the road construction project, so I know this has been an ongoing matter with regards to getting everything zoned correctly and for future development, but I just wanted to say that.
Thank you, Steve. Anyone else? Chris?
I just want to mention that it's appropriate for the property here to be rezoned for some type of use for medical use down the road. Knowing the couple that has lived here for a number of years, I think it's 40 plus years, it's just like a great next chapter for this property.
Thank you, Chris. Just to give you what we spoke about at planning, it obviously went through planning and was suggested to move forward. They have been working diligently to assemble this property and then again rezone it for redevelopment there. So it will be changing, but again, this is just the first step in the process. So There were no objections at planning to rezone this. So, with that, motion.
Kirkowski will make a motion that the council adopt ordinance 2908, an ordinance to approve a rezone of the properties at 7781 and 7811 South 13th Street to B4 Highway Business and a portion of 7869 South 13th Street to I-1 Institutional.
Oracle second. Roll call.
Alderman Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Guzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Item number seven, next public hearing, is consideration of a request by Camp Bow Wow for an amendment to the existing conditional use permit for additional dogs on a property for a doggy daycare and kennel operations on a property at 8411 South Liberty. Catherine.
Public hearing number two is to consider a request submitted by Brett Ippolit, Camp Bow Wow, for an amendment to the existing conditional use permit to allow additional dogs on the property as part of the dog daycare and kennel operations affecting the property located at 8411 South Liberty Lane. Applicant is Brett Ippolit, Camp Bow Wow, my apologies, property owner DDA Oak Creek LLC, care of Brett Ippolit. Legal description there follows. Date of notice is June 27, 2017.
Thank you, Catherine. Carrie?
This is a request to amend the existing CUP for this property. It was previously used for a doggy daycare. There is going to be an addition onto the rear of the property and also additional outdoor kennel areas, or not kennel areas, but rather outdoor exercise areas. So originally, the conditional use permit limited the number of dogs to a maximum of 50 on the site at any given time. There was a request for up to 137 dogs to be on the premises at any given time. Just for the council's edification, Puppy Playground, which was the original business there, ceased operations more than a year ago. So the Camp Bow Wow facility would be taking over, and this would be a great opportunity for that empty building to be reused for the purpose that it was originally intended. The addition will be approximately 51 feet by 101 feet. That will be forthcoming to the Plan Commission based on whether or not this conditional use amendment is approved. Five new outdoor kennels will be of various sizes, again, on the west of the proposed addition. Based on the conversation at the Plan Commission meeting, Plan Commission recommended that there would be a maximum of 125 dogs on the premises at any given time and a maximum of 80 boarded overnight. And this is based on the addition, and there is an additional portion of the conditions and restrictions that were presented to council that the increase in dogs be tied directly to the addition. If the council is of the mindset that this amendment is appropriate, there is a recommendation for adoption of the ordinance that would allow up to 125 dogs on site and 80 dogs overnight.
Thank you, Carrie. This is a public hearing. We will make three calls. Anybody wishing to speak, please, again, approach podium, name and address. This is the first call. Second call. Third and final call. We will now close the public hearing, and we will move on to consideration of an ordinance over Camp Bow Wow. Questions, comments from the commission, from the council?
Mayor, if
long night.
Mayor, if you can, or one of the planning commission members who was there, could maybe summarize the discussion over capacity. Unfortunately, there wasn't a lot of discussion on the addition, and there's no like visual on the addition. So I'm struggled a little bit to actually kind of come to terms with what that really looked like and what that meant.
But. We'll have the applicant come up and kind of explain it, and then we'll tell you how we arrived at the number. Best we can, because it was a long conversation. Welcome.
Hi, my name's Leah. I'm currently the camp director or general manager over at our Waukesha location.
Name and address.
I'm sorry, Leah Boschart, and then our address is 8411 South Liberty Lane.
Thank you.
So we have a current location out in Waukesha. Camp Bow Wow is a franchise, so there are currently 156 Camp Bow Wows around the country. So we're a really well-regulated organization. Corporate is very hands-on, make sure that we're following all the regulations and everything that they require for the business. Again, our main goals are happy, healthy pets equal happy, healthy people. So that's what we stand by, to provide premier services for our daycare dogs, which are dogs who just come for the day, and then our boarding dogs who stay overnight as well. We do have drawings of the building if you want to see that as well. So we plan on adding, it's currently a 3,000 square foot building, looking to add roughly 5,000 square feet. So it'll be a total of 8,000 square feet. We'll have roughly 80 boarding spaces for dogs overnight of varying sizes based on the size of the dogs. And then there are 5 indoor play yards, and each play yard leads to an outdoor play yard. So the dogs get the opportunity to go in and outside all day, which is great for them as well.
Hi, good evening. My name's Todd Abrams. My address is 2675 Pradham Avenue, Hoffman Estates, Illinois. What we're looking at up on the screen is the proposed site plan. As you can see, the 5,000 square foot addition will be added on to the westerly elevation of the existing building, which you see with the diagonal hatching. Small parking lot expansion is also proposed, along with new sidewalks, trash enclosure, landscaping to meet the current ordinance. Currently, the site has two driveways with access to Liberty. The east side of the property will be essentially matching those existing driveways. However, we'll be proposing to do full depth removal, replacements of the parking lot to more or less make the site brand new. I do have some elevations. Excuse me for not having a board.
Essentially, it's matching the existing building. So there's existing brick, vinyl siding, blue color. Forgive me, I'm not sure.
You know, on the addition you're planning, is that strictly for the boarding, or is that mixed? You're going to...
It's a mixture of both.
Both buildings will be used for boarding?
Yeah. So the kennel spaces, we call them cabins to match the Camp Bow Wow theme. So they're not crates that a dog goes in, but they're ample space for the dogs. There's cots provided. They're welcome to bring beds, blankets, toys, all that kind of stuff. So it's ample space for the dogs overnight, but the majority of their time is actually spent in the play yards interacting with the other dogs. So they're not in those cabins all day long. It's mainly feeding times and overnight that they're in there.
Do have a floor plan as well.
So all of these spaces are our cabins that the dogs will stay in. So again, there's roughly 80 of those. We will have 6 luxury suites, which are going to be mini rooms. So a little bit bigger than the typical cabin, but there's going to be cameras in there, so owners can pay a little bit more of a premium fee to be able to see their dogs at night while they're sleeping. Just kind of peace of mind. Surprisingly, people do enjoy that type of thing. So all of these spaces are where they stay overnight. Up here, we have those luxury suites. We'll also have a grooming room. We won't do haircuts right off the bat, but basic baths, nail trims, teeth brushing, that kind of stuff. And then the play yards are all spaced out over here. So we do separate dogs by size for their safety. So smaller dogs go with smaller dogs, larger dogs go with larger dogs. They all go through an interview process to make sure they're compatible in this type of environment. And then indoor play yards, again, lead to outdoor. So they get to run in and out all day as they please. Outdoors canine turf. So it's like...
You know, if you're using the entire of your... One is outdoor play areas, or is it a...
The outdoor play areas, you can see they're on the west side of the...
So they're what's kind of the hatched?
They're the fenced in. They kind of look at the little door symbols. All right, cool.
So those fences are solid vinyl fencing that's about 9 feet tall, so the dogs cannot see outside. There's no way for them to get out. Not possible. But again, indoor and outdoor access. Outside is canine turf, so it's like AstroTurf. But a really nice drainage system, so really easy to keep clean. No rocks, mud, gravel, anything like that. So nice and healthy for the dogs.
Gary, do we have any ordinances that I assume this meets whatever ordinance we have on the books for boarding and that kind of stuff?
They will be required to go through the health department to obtain a kennel license. Is it health department or is it clerks? It's the health department that regulates the kennel licenses, so they will be required to do that. As far as anything else, the proposed addition will have to go to the Plan Commission for all of those requirements. And it's really up to the council at this point whether the increase in the number of dogs tied to the proposed addition would be appropriate. There's nothing that says that they couldn't have this many dogs. They're basing this on about 60 square feet per dog.
Again, how many dogs did you suggest you'd have maximum?
Maximum overnight is 80.
And during the day?
During the day is a maximum of 125. That's based on play yard space in addition to overnight kennels. Just dogs who are there for the day.
Alderman Dukniak, 3rd District, I have a question as well. As I first saw this plan, I thought, okay, most of Lot 1 is available for the dogs. It is not. Just the kenneled areas with the defined fencing area. And then Carrie mentioned 60 square feet per dog. That's what regulation is?
No.
It's not a regulated
okay.
field.
Okay, so parent company, you said you're governed by the parent company?
Correct, yep, so this is all approved by them.
And okay, so then this meets with their approval?
Yes, absolutely. They suggested the 137 dogs, actually. Okay. So.
And because I've had my... I had my dog at the previous place.
Sure.
Wow, I can't envision 125 dogs all at the same time.
So we actually, again, we separate by size. The individual play yards, there's typically never more than 25 dogs per play yard.
Okay.
We compare it to a kindergarten group, if you will. So we don't have massive chaos of 125 dogs running around.
And there's also camp counselors out there.
Yes, thank you. Certified camp counselors in the play yard. So they all go through corporate training. They're trained by our seasoned staff. I did go to school for animal behavior, so this is kind of up my alley. I make sure everyone knows how to appropriately read dog body language. We also have live webcams, so you can watch the dogs while they're in the play yards, keep an eye on them. So we're very transparent to owners, so they know what's going on.
Okay. Thank you.
More, Ken?
The recommendation was for max boarding of 80 and 125
capacity? Yes.
Yes, and Chris, do you want to explain what went on at planning? Or
I was not at planning. I was on vacation.
There that night?
But Greg, were you there, or were you on vacation?
Oh, I was there. Oh, okay. It was a long discussion over square footage per dog, and we got quite an education on what was going on. And, of course, they were asking for 137. We came down to the 125 number after a lot of debate and also looking at what amenities would be out there and feeling confidence that the staff would be there able to handle them because, yeah, your first thought is they're all running at you like 101 Dalmatians or something.
Where are they going to put them all?
That's not the case, I promise.
No, but actually it's quite orderly, and that's the number we did come up with that we thought would be acceptable. There are other parts in the city, and Waukesha, I believe you had.
So we're currently
much more.
We have 108 in Waukesha as our max capacity. I keep it right around 100 usually, just for comfort level and safety of the dogs. Square footage is roughly 6,000 square feet in Waukesha, and our max capacity is again 108.
So if you didn't hear that on the mic, they're going to be 8,200 square foot with the increase in dogs of about 20.
That 8,200 includes the outdoor play space.
No, that's
just the interior. The indoor space is 8,200.
That's the building space.
Yeah, okay. Keep in mind that square footage includes office space. It includes the restroom area, the staff break area. So that's why one of those discussion points, getting to the 125 and 80 overnight max, was dealing with the space that was just devoted to dogs. So if you take the kennel areas plus the outdoor play areas, this is where the number came from, where the Plan Commission was comfortable with presenting to council 125 dogs max and 80 overnight.
Great point, Carrie. I forgot about that. Thank you.
So, Dan, as far as the minutes really didn't share a whole lot on the actually proposed new building. So, you guys?
We focused more on the dogs and the care, to tell you the truth, because the big question, the blaring question was, holy cow, 137.
Well, Rich, you know, I used the same building with Deb for a long time, so you know, even 50 dogs in the place was, you walked in the door, it was insane.
Right,
we are
chaos,
a little more regulated than that.
But, Carrie, you got any more explanation to it?
Well, the addition hasn't gone before the Plan Commission yet. This is step one, so that addition will have an extra level of scrutiny.
But we did have Okay. We did have the square footage.
It was just preliminary.
Yeah, it was
plans.
Glaring lack of actually, at least in the minutes of discussion on the addition.
Yeah, so, to be able to do the math per dog, and everybody was, of course, everybody loves their dog, so everybody had an opinion of how many square foot your dog should get. but that's how we arrived at the number, not very scientific, yeah. But given the presentation and the track record of Camp Bow Wow, we felt it appropriate at 125. Anything else? Nothing else. Motion, please.
Lorick moves that the council adopt Ordinance 2904, an ordinance to amend the conditions and restrictions in Ordinance Number 2399 to allow a maximum of 125 dogs on site as part of the existing conditional use permit for an animal boarding kennel slash dog daycare facility with outdoor exercise area at the property of 8411 South Liberty Lane.
Dukniak, second.
Roll call. Oh, well, I'm sorry. Before we go, floor is yours, Melissa. That's okay. We have an ordinance typo. Is it 2904 or is it
2904 and 2399?
And actually, the paperwork reads 2904.
I believe it should be 2904, amending 2399.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we're correct. Okay, we had a motion in the second, I believe.
Yep.
Yes. Roll call.
Alderman Gale.
Aye.
Guzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Tillman.
Aye.
Great. Thank you very much. Item number 9 is a consideration of a proposed amendment to specify, clarify permitted conditional uses within a planned unit development and to renumber subsequent sections of the code. Catherine?
Public hearing number 3 is to consider a proposed amendment to section 17.0325 to specify and clarify permitted and conditional uses within a planned unit development and to renumber subsequent subsections of the code. Date of notice, July 11th, 2018.
Carrie?
This proposal is to basically say specifically what is allowed in a PUD as permitted and conditional. Currently, the code states what is allowed as a permitted use. However, there's nothing specified for conditional uses. So the text amendment that staff is proposing is to change the wording in the permitted uses section slightly and then add that second section regarding conditional uses, stating when a use is requested, what is going to be required, that it has to be compliant with other sections of code, and that there has to be a recommendation by the Plan Commission before it goes to the Common Council. So this is intended to provide clear direction to applicants, consultants, staff, the Plan Commission, and ultimately the Common Council regarding PUD allowed uses. And the Plan Commission did review this on July 10th at their meeting and recommended approval. This does have a direct correlation to an upcoming planned unit development for 13th and Ryan. So there is a recommendation that if the council feels this is appropriate, that the council adopts Ordinance 2907 to basically create this section that specifies the permitted and conditional uses in a planned unit development.
Thank you, Carrie. As this is a public hearing, we will make 3 calls. This will be the first call.
Hardin Digner, 8540 South Pennsylvania Avenue. Is the purpose of this amendment to direct individuals to the various requirements? Because it doesn't seem as though it's completely necessary.
So the requirements in a PUD only specified that that permitted uses were allowed. This is actually clarifying that conditional uses are also allowed in a PUD. It gives the circumstances under which a conditional use can be requested as part of the PUD and what would be allowed as a permitted use. So it's really more of a clarification item rather than trying to change anything. It's kind of, we have a lot of refer to this section in this part of Chapter 17, refer to this section. It basically is putting everything that's required in a PUD, specifying permitted versus conditional in that same subsection. It's really not changing anything, it's really clarifying.
Thank you, Arden. Second call. Third and final call. And I'll close the public hearing and move on to item 10, which is consideration of an ordinance to change that section. Questions from the council? Comments? Seeing none?
Just wait 1 second. Sorry, Danny.
Oh, okay.
Carrie, or Andrew, maybe you. Is the legislative change last year to the conditional use permit laws have any bearing on what we're doing here?
No.
Is that separate? Okay.
No, it does not.
And once again, just to reiterate, the planning department, it's really more of a clarification, be a little more transparent, make sure it's up front and everybody knows just what's going on. So
is the key to this, Carrie, that we're actually getting a recommendation from planning on all conditional use permits? Or?
This is what's allowed as part of a PUD. So specifically whenever a plan unit development is presented, they will have to specify what are the permitted uses that they are requesting, what are the conditional uses that they are requesting to be allowed in the PUD. Anything that would change from the underlying zoning district that would be for review as part of the PUD. It's rather than stating that it's allowing for the Plan Commission to basically look at what is always going to be allowed within that PUD. Instead of just referring back to the underlying zoning district, if there are any changes or any clarifications, the PUD allows some flexibility for those uses, but they still have to meet the criteria for each of those. So it really doesn't change anything, but it still specifies what's allowed, both permitted, and what will need additional scrutiny.
Anyone else? Not motion, please.
I'll move to approve ordinance 2907, an ordinance to repeal and recreate section 17.0325 of the municipal code to specify and clarify permitted and conditional uses within a planned unit development and to renumber subsequent sections accordingly.
Guzikowski, a second.
Roll call.
Alderman Guzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
New business, item 11, it's consideration of a resolution accepting financial statements from the auditor's report in 2017 as prepared by Baker, Tilley, Viceroy, and Kraus. So who do we have here? Bridget.
Good evening. So every year we bring to you the financial statements from the prior fiscal year and ask for you to review them and accept them into the record. So in addition to the presentation that's in your packet, you should have also received in your mailbox two blue binders, one that is your financial statements and one that is the formal report communicating to you and the residents the status of your internal controls and the processes that we have here. So in reviewing 2017, we had another really good year, which is always a happy story to be able to tell that we added $500,000 to our general fund balance. That is no secret with the building permit revenue that we received and maintaining that conservative budget throughout each of our years, so we do not plan on that revenue coming in. We also had various vacant positions and retirements in multiple departments over 2017, which helped our expenditures stay low, as well as low fuel costs, and some of our energy costs were less than we budgeted. So our fund balance at the end of the year increased by 6.67%. So again, positive news. And we are within our 15 to 25% range for our fund balance policy. in the communication to those charged with governance, that binder explains that we have the same audit note that we have every year, which is that we are not in-house completing our financial statements. I tell you, even if we did complete the financial statements, there would be a different form of a note saying that we don't have enough people to approve and review those statements. So that's nothing to be alarmed about. That is normal for communities of our size to have that note. Outside of that note, we have some existing policies that need to be written within our IT department that have been present within this report since 2015. So it's actually really significant that we have no other notes from our auditors that they want us correcting here over the next year. So I want to thank Clerk's Office, Treasurer's Office, and the Finance Department and the work over the last year on just keeping our financials in good form. So with that, there is a presentation that is in your packet, and I would ask that Steve from Baker Tilly come up and give you the rundown.
Good evening. My name is Steve Henke. I'm a senior manager with Baker Tilly. Been involved with the City of Oak Creek's financial audit for a number of years. With me is Tim Sawinski. Tim is our senior accountant. He's the guy that's in the field here during the duration of the audit work. And the partner involved with the engagement, Wendy Younger, was unable to be here this evening. But I will run through the brief presentation that you should each have in your packets. We were engaged to audit the 2017 financial statements of the city. We have done that, and we have expressed an opinion. Our opinion is the only pages in that 80-plus page document that's ours as your auditors. It's right in the front of the document, on pages 1 through 3 and the Roman numerals. Our opinion, in technical terms, was an unmodified opinion. In layman's terms, it's a clean opinion. It's what you want to hear from us as your auditors. The financial statements contain over 80-plus pages. I'll use the six-page, seven-page handout to kind of run through a few of the key highlights, really just emphasizing the nice summary that Bridget just gave you, because she took quite a bit of my my prepared remarks. So we'll just reaffirm those. So on page one, you can see your fund balance there. As Bridget mentioned, it increased about $500,000 from the previous year. You see in front of you really a five-year running total of the fund balances. Pretty consistent year in and year out. The change this year maybe is in the categorization, so to speak, of the fund balance. About $1.7 million is non-spendable. The biggest chunk of that is you've got some funds that are running, expenditures have exceeded the revenues, so there's some due to, due froms. The general fund is in essence borrowing money to a couple of the other funds. And over time, the plan would be that would be replaced, but from a reporting standpoint, it's categorized as probably a non-current receivable from a general fund's perspective at 12/31/17. So you can see your unassigned is about $4.8 million at the end of 17. With that $4.8 million, I know when I stand in front of this body every year, I always get the question, well, how does that compare to other communities of similar size? And we audit a vast number of communities within the state of Wisconsin, so we've got a little bit of a database accumulated. Again, as Bridget mentioned, you have a policy that's 15 to 25% of a calculated threshold. Following that calculation, you're at just under 18%, which is within your policy. If you compare the unassigned available fund balance to expenditures, that percentage actually increases a little bit to just over 21%. The Government Finance Officers Association, which sets forth some general policies for governments, they recommend that you have no less than 2 months of operating expenses available in your fund balance. That would equate to just under 17%. So you're within that parameter. When I look at some of the other similar sized municipalities that we audit, we see a range. We've got some high ones that are at 40%. We've got some on the low side at 16, and kind of that medium is that mid 20%. So you folks are right in that range. You're within your policy, and you're within kind of the industry averages, so to speak. So moving on to page two of the handout, here's really your summary. Again, in a five-year picture in terms of total revenues and total expenditures for your general fund, see on the right side of the page there, you added just over the $500,000 to fund balance. Moving to page three, again, a snapshot of the revenues. If you strictly look at what was budgeted from a revenue standpoint, excluding any transfer activity, you're just over $500,000 to the good from a budgetary standpoint. Moving to page four, shows the detail of your major revenue categories, taxes, intergovernmental, transfers, and then other. And as Bridget noted, the big increase in the other was related around the building permits and associated permits that go along with the building construction. The graph at the top of the page really is the key. Those lines pretty much go straight across the page. So, you know, over, you know, the last 5 years, your four major revenue sources, for all practical purposes, have been flat and or consistent, whatever method term you want to use there. Moving on to page five is a chart of the expenditures. Again, from a strict budgetary standpoint, excluding transfers, the actual expenditures were about $850,000 less than what was originally budgeted. So again, city is living within its means and the budget, conservative on the revenue budget, living within the means on the expenditure budget, generally ends up with positive results at the end of the year. Moving to page six, again, looking at the major functions, focusing on that chart at the top of the page, again, consistent with the revenues, the expenditures have been, for all practical purposes, pretty consistent over the last 5 years. Again, if your revenues are flat, you're forced to keep the expenditures flat as well. And then the last page of the handout just focuses on the GO borrowing and the capacity. Again, looking at a five-year trend here, at the end of 17, you've got about 39% of the borrowing capacity available, meaning you've used about 61% of the borrowing capacity. And kind of right in the range of where the city has been over the last 4 or 5 years. As Bridget mentioned, we also issued a communication report. We did have an internal control comment in there, as she mentioned, related to preparing the financial statements. Given the rules that we have to follow by and report under, that does become a control matter when we've been asked to prepare the financial statements. Other than that, there were a couple of other, as mentioned, the IT comments, and also a number of other informational points. There's a number of new governmental accounting standard reporting requirements that are coming down the road, so they're not going to be effective for a year or two down the road, but just to put them out there and inform you as to what's going on. The other section of that report is items that we as your auditors are required to communicate to the council. I won't go through the 15 individual items. You certainly can look at those as on your leisure. I will summarize them and say that they're normal and customary. There were no unusual items that we as your auditors are required to report to the council. Everything else was as expected. We received the full cooperation of management and staff and appreciate that. And with that, those were my prepared remarks, so I'll be happy to respond to questions.
Questions from the council? Mike, you got some?
Yeah, does the equalized value number on that last page, on page 7, is that directly proportional to the debt limit? Is that why your debt limit goes up?
Yes.
Pretty sure.
Yep, the GO debt limit is 5% of that equalized value. So as that number goes up, your capacity would expand.
Because we tend to borrow with development being the reason why we are borrowing for that infrastructure. And more often than not, we are seeing that development obviously add to our equalized value. So we're continually chasing that number essentially in the actions that we're having. So we have stayed at that 40% of our debt capacity for the last few years.
Anyone else? No, so overall, we are good.
Good report.
That's what we want to hear on a Monday night. Thank you. All right, thank you, Bridget. Item 12, consideration of a resolution authorizing the issuance. Jumped right ahead. We need a motion on that, please.
Bridget, congratulations on preparing and bringing us through and helping present a nice solution and result for the city. But that said, Gail will move to approve resolution 11970-080618, accepting the 2017 financial statement and auditor's report as prepared and presented by Baker Tilly Virchow Krause LLP.
Kirkowski, second. Roll call.
Alderman Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gail.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye. Now item 12 is consideration of a resolution for issuance and sales of approximately $5,150,000 of general obligation refunding bonds. Bridget.
Sure. It will be a little bit easier for me to talk about both item 12 and 13 at the same time. So what we are looking at is the infrastructure, the debt for the infrastructure for Oakview Business Park. So we have $10.5 million roughly over two different short-term notes that we have done since 2015 with these funds. The district got caught in the economic downturn, and normally we would just use the one short-term note, but we had to extend and do a second short-term note. So we are now here at the point in time where the district is leveling out, things are looking much better, and we're going to take that short-term debt into long-term, which is the plan. What happens after we have a short-term note for infrastructure is we have to review all of the costs for that infrastructure and determine what of those expenditures were for solely public purpose, like our roads or our right-of-way, and where did we do any potential grading that served for the private property. So when you have a mass site like we did with Drexel Town Square, this is the same process. As well as Oakview, we called in our bond council, called in Kevin from HSE, and sat down and looked at the expenditures, came up with a percentage of what was public versus private, and that's how we came to the $2 amounts for the taxable. I'm going backwards, but the taxable is item 13 of the $5.3 million, and then the item 12 of the tax-exempt bonds. So that is where we are sitting today. And as is normal, the morning of the Common Council meeting, we take the bonds out for sale. And at that point, I will have Kevin come up from HSE and explain a little bit about the two bonds and where they ended up with the rate. But then I just remembered Moody's. And so I'm going to say that we also went through the process as we do with our bonds that we were rated by Moody's. They affirmed our AA2 rating for these new issues as well as our outstanding issues. So we had Moody's actually in the city a few weeks ago, time is flying, and gave them a tour, let them see what we've been doing and how we have made the impact with these debt obligations. And they were pleased, and that also helped explain when they can remember real life what Oakview Business Park looks like from their trip up here.
Thanks, Bridget. And as Bridget mentioned, there are two things I really wanted to talk to you about this evening. The first was the rating and
Can you introduce yourself?
I'm Kevin Mullen from Hutchinson Shockey Early and Company, working with the city as their underwriter, continuing the work that Paul Thompson had done.
nice, and the sound is what is important for me. So we can make a real tall waterfall very quiet, or we can make a very short waterfall very loud. So whatever we want to do there, you know. Sure. You know, these type of features, there's not a lot of maintenance. Every feature that we design at Aquatica is 10 minutes or less a week of maintenance. I would be out of business if these were high maintenance features. So this feature here is what's called a pondless waterfall. There's no, you know, koi pond on it. There's no pond on it. There might be a little reflection pool in the middle there, but there's really no pond. It's very much a system where it recirculates, but at the end of the feature, it disappears. So where it disappears at the corner of the building there, there's a reservoir underground, and then it recirculates up to the top of the waterfalls there. So there's very little maintenance involved with that. Those type of features, they don't need a lot of care. They recirculate. The reservoir basin can fluctuate, and really it's just a feature meant to be enjoyed. It's the lowest maintenance feature that can be built, especially in a public setting with safety issues and things like that. Extremely safe. A child could literally walk onto the reservoir pebble that's there and gravel that's there, and it's just like walking on a regular floor. There's no danger of falling through.
So that being said, there's a whole bunch of people from the committee. If anyone has any questions about the project, we're looking at a timeline of early fall to get started, so that it would be completed by late October.
Questions, Steve?
Alderman Krakowski, First District. You may not have these figures yet, but would you have monthly costs with regards to electricity, maintenance, and the annual maintenance costs that you have here? I see those figures, $900, but monthly costs idea, and then
so the monthly
who pays the monthly costs?
So the monthly cost for the electricity will be about $50. We already talked to Dick Kolka in the maintenance department, and he did not see that as being a difficulty in adding to the overall electrical cost of the building. As for the monthly maintenance costs, it's basically, I can let Dean or Tom talk to that a little bit more, but it's my understanding that's basically putting in some algicide as needed. So it's very minimal. And the annual maintenance cost we would anticipate would either come from private donations or could come out of the library's maintenance budget.
And I'm not being a Debbie Downer here. I just, you know, because of the environment that we live in with regards to sometimes the misinformed public see things and they just jump to conclusions before they get all the information, which, by the way, I think with the previous agenda items, Leslie could do some wonders with those items. But I know we got rid of the original waterscape because the fire department needed money and they didn't have money. So anyways, won't get into that. I just want to perhaps make sure that when it's all said and done, that there's, I suggest, proper signage and continual communications that this was privately funded, privately constructed, and like no taxpayers' monies was used, because we have that perception out there.
The group has actually already talked about that, and we've already envisioned a rock of some sort that would list the different individuals who've donated to the project.
Okay, that's it. Thank you.
That was very important for us because we thought the same thing, that that's what the taxpayer coming in to pay is going to be thinking, is how can we afford this? Well, it is all private donation.
Thank you.
Alderman Dukniak, 3rd District. First off, thanks to the committee for having the vision to make such a significant improvement to the facility. I mean, that's amazing. As I look at the garden costs and fundraising figures, I mean, certainly you're at about 40% of covering the costs. What is your short-term plan to continue to raise? I mean, if the project's going to begin shortly, we're a little cash short right now, unless you're providing some incredible terms.
I am. Yeah, Tom's a friend. I'll work with
okay,
him.
Okay, God bless. It's not what you know, it's who you know.
No, Dean, you're covered.
We have several different asks out there. Actually, since you have received the budget, we've gotten another $5,000 committed to the project. We have several other places that we're currently in the process of doing an ask for. In the meantime, we would go to the foundation and ask that they would cover the cost. All of the money is the Library Foundation will be the fiduciary agent on this project, so the money will go through there. So we would use some of the current money in the bank account to cover the upfront cost.
Is there a contingency plan? I mean, that's such a beautiful looking area. I noticed three benches that are incorporated into the plan. I mean, really, with it being such an attractive...
So the plan is actually
a plan for seating expansion?
Yes. So there's two different pieces to this. So there's the Serenity Garden, which is the part that Aquatica is doing, and then the other piece of it, I'm going to turn over to Tom Marciniak because he is going to be talking a little bit about the social terrace. The idea is to activate the space by bringing a place for library patrons and people who just come and visit City Hall to have another opportunity, another area to enjoy the space.
Great. Thank you.
So, Tom.
That was my cue.
Okay.
Thank you. Where you see the two benches, we're planning to put...
Tom, do you want to introduce yourself? Do you want to introduce yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry. Tom Marciniak, 7554 South Pine Avenue. Where you see the two benches up on the picture and from the overhead right here, we're envisioning tables along with umbrellas. We're envisioning some chairs, making it the true Serenity Garden that we're referring to. Not just the water feature is beautiful, but we want to put plants in. We want to incorporate a number of features into it to beautify it even further. We want to make it part of the library, so it's a place where people could go read a book, sit down, visit with friends, whatever. Make it more of an area for the library to make it more appealing. My wife worked for the public library here in Oak Creek for 27 years. She passed away last year. I'm a benefactor of this project along with several other people. This is as much personal as it is to beautify the City Hall and the library. So I just thought I'd mention that. We're excited about this. We really are. We think it's going to be beautiful for you, for the citizens here, and a great memorial for our wives. And we hope you'll approve it.
Tom or Mike, you probably know. Have you guys looked at any issue underneath the grade here at all?
We've met with Dick. Dick has been helping us out. There is no problem with the grade. The water that'll be, or the ground that'll be moved for the well will be put to the other side and used for the waterfall.
We have no utilities or anything worried about there? Right.
No. Just the irrigation that'll be relocated into the new flower beds.
Very appealing design, Tom. So hopefully you guys can find a way to get it done. So,
are there any issues with contamination? I know some of these water features, not necessarily outdoor, but I know indoors have had issues in the past. Is there anything we have to be concerned about an outdoor?
This is back to you. You can stay here. You can be my wingman. Really no issue with contamination.
Got to come in the microphone.
Not an issue really with contamination as far as these are concerned. They're very safe. The water, I call it polished. The water gets polished 24/7. And we do add a natural bacteria and enzyme product, a beneficial bacteria and enzyme product to digest muck or sludge or any debris that would fall into the system. It's a closed system, so there it gets rainfall and it gets filled with an autofill, like a garden hose. So the water continuously being polished like that, really doesn't have a lot of airborne pathogens or bad bacterias or stagnant water or mosquitoes, things like that. There's not a lot that can really happen. In fact, this type of system, the water is much, much more healthier than a river or a lake, retention pond, even a backyard kiddie pool that can sit stagnant and have problems. So not a problem.
One other question. The under the fundraising numbers you've got there, when it's referred to as committed, does that mean money in hand or are those pledges or what is that exactly?
Currently, $1,000 of it is pledges. Everything else is money in hand.
Okay. Good. That's a good thing. Because I know, didn't you approach the Lions or?
We have not approached the Lions yet.
You haven't?
Not yet.
Well, that's gonna happen.
Right. We can't tell you the entire plan.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's in the plan.
Jerry Hamernick's involved too, so there's a plan for
fundraising. He's supposed to be in New York, he told me.
Yeah.
Oh, way to go. Okay, thanks.
Chris? Alderman Chris Guzikowski. So exceptional. I mean, this thing just looks phenomenal. I think this will be a welcome addition. My concern with the welcome addition is if you walk around the building day in and day out, you just see how much trash and things that blows around. So that's one concern I have about how we're going to keep that clean on a regular basis. We did a lot of, with our fall cleanup, we did a lot of garbage pickup and it just gets entangled everywhere. So you hate to see something as beautiful as this built and then we need to maintain it. So I just was curious what that plan was. And then also a question on the funding. Do you have any plans out there or how are you raising the money? Do you have any pledge cards or how are you doing that?
Right now we're just going out to individuals or businesses and asking one-on-one. Okay. As for the maintenance, we've been working with the Friends of the Library. Jerry's the president. And so we have been talking about the possibility of starting some sort of volunteer organization that could not only help with pruning the flower beds and all of that, but would also, kind of day-to-day maintenance. Right now, the Friends of the Library come in once a month and dust the library because that's something that we just don't have the manpower, the employees to manage. And so we would hope that the Friends seem very interested and willing to add that to their group of responsibilities.
So if I may, so we're looking at a concept, something like a garden club. Greendale has them.
Yep.
So it's a concept that we're going to be exploring more late fall and winter so that we're ready when we do planting in the spring that we have established probably seniors, younger seniors that can take over the project. And I think they'll take great ownership with it. It works in other cities, and we understand very well the draining that it... We met with Debbie. So we understand what the city load is on landscaping. Very clearly we do.
Thank you.
Just one comment that I thought of when I was reading this staff report last week and then kind of saw in real time as early voting started last week at City Hall, we need to be very conscious. It states in the staff report that there will be times where the south entrance is partially closed or completely closed. That really can't happen during those early voting. So just it can be coordinated and managed, but just know that has to be.
And we already talked with Dick about that actually last week after I had submitted the staff report. That was one of the things that he and I talked about is that we can't close off that hand. He was very adamant that we can't close off that handicapped ramp either. So that's something that we'll work with Dean and the concrete people with to make that happen. The general idea that we had with Dick is that we would maybe close off one set of doors just to make it safe. But I do think, go ahead, Tom.
Plus, Dean will be in here. He's scheduled for October 1st, and that's 2 weeks for the pond to be built. So after he's done, what we have to do is basically clean up on the the outsides of the pond, create the flower beds, put borders in with them, and we're going to obtain a landscape service to help us set those. Once those are done, we're going to put that all to bed for the winter. So we really envision being completely done with what we're going to do this year by November 1st. And I don't think that's too aggressive of a plan. Certainly Dean needs to be out of here by the 15th of October.
Yeah, and we don't think the landscaping portion of it would require anything to be closed off.
Absolutely not.
Greg, you're the only one. Anything?
I just wanted to thank everybody at the library, everybody on the committee involved. I really think it's beautiful. I think it's going to be a great addition to the library, City Hall, and the surrounding areas. I mean, I imagine with the waters going in next door, residents there would love to walk over here, come to the library, and visit this area. So thank you, everybody.
Mayor Dan, I actually have one more comment.
Go ahead, Rich.
In regard, Jill, to reaching out to community groups. Looks like Mike has spoken on behalf of the Oak Creek Lions Club, the Oak Creek Kiwanis Club. Have you reached out to them?
No, but they're on our list,
okay,
too.
I can speak on behalf of the Oak Creek Kiwanis Club. Our membership and financial resources aren't quite as big as Lions, but I'm pretty confident that I can get the Oak Creek Kiwanis Club to, you know, back your project as well.
That would be wonderful.
Sounds like a betting war.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
No, it's a great project.
Very quickly, a couple of comments. Again, looks very good. Should have been here when we built the place. Just, it's harder to come back and do this when things are done. And that's where my questions lie. We have a couple of trees there. They're going to be moved by Trees on the Move or something like that. I'll ask my questions. You can get them all at once, okay. Tom. The concrete, we have stamped concrete there. You're going to come in with excavation equipment. We need to protect that concrete, or you guys are going to have to be liable probably to fix it, I would think. And then thirdly, is there going to be any illumination on this at night, or will it run at night? Obviously, it'll be on timers, but what do you envision for that?
The waterfall run on a timer. The lighting, there is going to be low voltage lighting that Dean's going to put in as well. And it's going to be excellent quality, placed such to illuminate very well, both under the water and the major waterfalls. So you guys will be able to see it from the council chamber. What else?
The concrete protect. Just the concrete, how the equipment's coming in and out, guys.
That's what I've been working with Dick on and Jerry for the last 10 days with what size of equipment can come up those steps, how, and we're pretty confident, or we're very confident on exactly how to remove the concrete and to prepare that surface.
And then trees, are they going
to
be?
Oh, the trees. We had talked to Debbie. Those are not the optimal trees for a pond, too small of leaves. They are very happy to move those trees. They've got locations for all four of them. And the replacement trees will probably be put in late fall or spring, depending on the final shape of the pond and the creek, because that's an artistic rendering. Once he gets the right rocks, we'll see where the pockets are for the right trees. To provide shade, that we'll be able to use this pond every day, all day.
Well, it sounds like you got all the bases covered from what I had. I'm in full support of it. It looks great. Again, I just wish it would have been done a few years back.
We'll be working very closely with Dick every step of the way from here.
Okay. I think that's it. Anything else for him while we got him here? Nope. All right. Thank you, everybody.
Good job, guys.
Item 15,
Another informational treasurer's report. We have Barb with us tonight.
Hello. So the numbers you have here on the report are for all of the investment and banking accounts ending June 30th, 2018. Beginning balance was $38,713,418.75. Ending balance, $34,727,739.74. Interest earned was $57,727.37. So it decreased over the month by just under $4 million. As you can see, tax collection is coming to an end. Well, it has ended now, but as of this report, just over $860,000 we collected in June, 1.1% of the total levied. City share was approximately $262,500.
Okay. Questions for Barb? None. Thank you, Barb.
Thanks, Barb.
Item 16 is consideration of a motion to concur with a mayoral appointment to celebrations for Cindy Bausch. Any questions? If none, motion.
I'll move to concur with the mayor's appointment of Cindy Bausch, 3-year term celebrations committee expiring April of 2021.
Guzikowski, I'll second.
Roll call.
Alderman Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Guzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Item 17 is consideration of a resolution to accept the workmanship of CW Perpero and authorizing the final payment for the project on a Kia Way Phase 2. And we have Mike Simmons with us. A little narrative, Mike.
Sure. Thank you, Mayor. Yes, this was the second phase of the IKEA Way road construction. Also included the utilities and traffic signals at the intersection of IKEA Way and Drexel Avenue. And again, this has been a phased project. This was the second phase. Third phase is contemplated to sometime in the not too distant future. With that phase three water main project that was recently completed, there was grading for that last phase of the roadway done already. So that was to accommodate the wetland permitting, which would we've got about another 3.5 years before that wetland designation runs out, would have to be done again. So it would be nice if that would happen within that time frame. At any rate, so the project was constructed, started in the fall of 2016, wrapped up then in the summer of 17. And this phase took it from basically the elementary school's north driveway to its current north terminus, spanning across the frontage of the IKEA store. Some challenges with the project. The road itself is constructed within an easement across Milwaukee County Park property, Falk Park, and so it's not traditional in the sense that it is in city-controlled public road right-of-way. And as the project got underway, we had agreements. We had negotiated this agreement for that easement protocol for them reviewing plans and giving input. That all happened as we got under construction. Some Milwaukee County staff came out and they were surprised with what they saw. So I would say that the communication was lacking on their end as far as getting their key staff involved. So they were quite alarmed with what they saw happening out there. We met with them over the course of several weeks in, I guess, they viewed as mitigating the damage that had already been done. And so in that process, they put quite a few requirements in place. That was to get us off dead center. We were basically stopped out there. And so that's where we have come in with some additional costs on the project. Basically, the project was, let's see here, $2.12 million. As-built costs are $2.24 million. So about $117,000 we would be paying out above the bid price. So, again, this was a unit price contract. We had some pretty big fluctuations in some items coming in well below planned quantity, others above, and then, of course, with the items that Mauk County Parks were requiring, that boosted the cost a bit as well.
Just to put a little more positive spin on this, I'll just have council recall that this was actually a negotiated amendment to the IKEA deal that allowed for this underground work to proceed. If you recall, we had some very favorable bids for phase one. We had some money left on the table per that development agreement, which otherwise would have, I mean, remained unspent, but in a kind of a roundabout way would have really went to IKEA in the form of a PAYGO, as debt service would have been lower. You recall this discussion. So really it was a positive story in the end. We had some additional costs to help out, you know, some of the requirements Milwaukee County put on in the middle of the, you know, some of these projects. But that was money more or less that was unspent from phase one due to some favorable bids. So all in all, there was still a savings on the amount that was originally bonded. And I will also note that just per the earlier discussion, this is that last piece of short-term debt that we have out there. So I wanted to bring that back around for the council that this is exactly what we're talking about here, which we'll refinance in December timeframe.
Greg. Just a few questions. With the underground work and the grading that was done towards 27th Street, is that kind of putting in place where the road would be, and is there a time frame on that, or is that contingent on any development that'll be proposed for that area? And then with that, the fact that the wildlife barrier and such was required for this short portion, do you anticipate the same issues continuing through Falk Park more and having to put up more wildlife barriers?
Yes. So as the water main plans were being completed, there was a road plan that was designed, which would probably take it to, I would say, on the level of a 50% design. So when that road does get constructed, we're halfway there as far as finishing that design off. So that is constructed to a road subgrade alignment, vertical and horizontal alignment. So so yes, that's taken care of. Discussions with Milwaukee County Parks is that when that road continues, that wildlife barrier continues as well. Right of entry permits that they require. So I guess they will, you know, have another kick at the cat as far as getting what they feel they need out there to protect the park and the wildlife. So the good news is, I mean, it's really where that road ends now. We're going to continue slightly north and then quickly head west. And it's not too far before we're off of Milwaukee County Parks property, and then we would be crossing property that is owned by Northwestern. And as far as the timing, that's really in the property owner's hands if things start shaping up for development of that property. So
I'm trying to think, is the sidewalk inward of the wildlife barrier, or is that towards the street side?
The sidewalk runs along the east side of the roadway now and just ends there. So we would be, you know, continuing it around the outside of that curve as we head to the west.
That'll all be, I've never been really all back there. Is that all wooded? There's not going to actually be park area for walkways or anything. It's just going to be kind of wooded through the county property?
Right. I mean, okay. We would do the clearing to do the we would do the clearing for that 80-foot wide easement, and that's it. You know, they're not going to let us do anything more. So,
thank you.
Any other questions? If not, motion, please.
Lorick will move to approve resolution number 11969-080618, accepting the workmanship of CW Preparo and authorizing final payment for project number 15023, IKEA Way Phase 2.
Yak, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Gale.
Aye.
Kuzakowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Item 18 is consideration of motion to approve the July 31st, 2018 vendor summary in the amount of $814,746.38. Any questions, please direct them to Bridget. No questions. Whenever someone's ready, motion.
It will move to approve the July 31st, 2018 vendor summary report in the combined total amount of $814,746.38.
Kuzakowski, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Kuzakowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Community development, item 19 is consideration of a resolution approving a certified survey map from Michael Faber, Ryan Business Park LLC, for the property at 741 West Ryan Road.
The proposal is to divide and reconfigure the lot that is in red on the screen. There is a CSM proposed that would divide this into three lots. And we'll go through several pages here, so bear with me. Lot 1 is proposed to be about 6.9 acres. It contains the existing buildings that are on the property and will be retained by the current landowners. Lot 2 is approximately 31.7 acres, which is south of the creek. It will be conveyed to the applicant and will be part of the proposed PUD for Ryan Business Park. Outlot 1, which is on the next page, actually it's on this page right here, the outlot 1 is going to be for part of the creek. It's the remaining acreage from 70 feet of the center line of the creek south, and that will be conveyed to Milwaukee County. Lot 2, which continues on the next page, contains some wetlands, and it is also appearing to be landlocked in this CSM. So the temporary condition of the landlocked parcel is something that staff has recommended to incorporate a notation prior to recording, referencing a future CSM, which is CSM number 4, which will be for review tonight. CSM 4 depicts the expanded lot 2, which would go all the way out to 13th Street, and therefore it would no longer be landlocked. This initial CSM, though, doesn't show that, so just to quell any concerns, we are requiring that there be a reference to CSM 4. Wetlands and floodplain areas have been delineated and are shown. There is a typo that the applicant is aware of regarding South 13th Street. Staff concerns were also prepared and submitted to the applicant. Those have been or are in the process of being addressed. There are three recommended conditions of approval that were presented for council review from the Plan Commission. One, that a label indicating the acreage for lot one, or outlot one rather, is included on the map prior to recording. Two, then a note referencing that proposed CSM number 4 is included. And three, the standard all technical corrections are completed prior to recording the parcel, or the map rather. And if the council is satisfied with the CSM as proposed with the conditions, there is a recommendation that council adopts the resolution approving the CSM. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Carrie. Any questions for Carrie regarding this first CSM? None. Motion, please.
Gail will move to approve resolution 11965-080618, approving a certified survey map from Michael Faber, Ryan Business Park LLC, for the property at 741 West Ryan Road, with a notation to include a reference to CSM number 4 is carried noted.
Kuzikowski, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gail.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Item 20 is also a consideration of a certified survey map for Michael Faber, Ryan Business Park, LLC, for the property at 9900 South 13th Street. Carrie?
Again, this is a proposal to divide and reconfigure the lot that is in red on the screen. This will create three lots, essentially. Lot 1 is proposed to be about 12.3 acres for future development. Lot 2 is proposed to be approximately 2 acres, and that will be part of the previous Lot 2 for the CSM we just reviewed. And Outlot 2 is approximately 15.5 acres, contains a majority of the wetlands and floodplain. Again, this will be conveyed to Milwaukee County. As with the previous CSM, Lot 2 appears to be landlocked. This is a temporary condition. Again, we'll have that CSM number 4 reference on the map prior to recording. The wetlands and floodplain, again, are delineated and shown. There is still that typo for South 13th Street. The applicant and the surveyor have been made aware of this. Staff concerns were presented and, again, are either in the process of being addressed or have been addressed. Again, with the conditions of approval, Plan Commission has recommended approval, and there is a recommendation provided for Council that they adopt the resolution approving the certified survey map. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Carrie. Any questions concerning this CSM, part of the same development? None? Motion, please.
Carrie, sorry, Dan.
Oh.
Carrie, did you want the reference to item CSM number 4 in this motion as well?
It should be a part of the resolution.
We'll move then to approve resolution 11966-080618, approving a certified survey map for Michael Faber, Ryan Business Park LLC, for the property at 9900 South 13th Street.
Is it Kuzikowski, second?
Roll call.
Alderman Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gail.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye. Item 21 is consideration of a certified survey map for Michael Faber, Ryan Business Park, LLC, for the property at 9600 South 13th, in the same development. Carrie?
Another proposal to divide and reconfigure the lot, with three lots proposed. Lot 1 is proposed to be approximately 28 acres and will be conveyed to Ryan Business Park for future development. Outlot 3 is approximately 3.6 acres, contains a portion of the creek, which is 70 feet north and 70 feet south of the center line, contains much of the floodway, and will be retained by Milwaukee County. Outlot 4 will be approximately 1.2 acres, contains a portion of the creek north and south of the center line, and also will be retained by Milwaukee County. There is an 80-foot gap between outlots 3 and 4. This is part of Lot 1. This is also intended to be part of right-of-way. Wetlands and floodplain, again, have been delineated and shown. Same typo. Staff concerns were presented to the applicant. They are currently in the process of being addressed or have been addressed. Same considerations as previously mentioned, and Plan Commission had recommended Council approval. There is a recommendation for approval of the certified survey map through resolution. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Carrie. Questions from the Council? If none, motion, please.
Yeah, we'll move to approve resolution 11967-080618, approving a certified survey map for Michael Faber, Ryan Business Park LLC, for the property at 9600 South 13th Street.
Kuzikowski, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gail.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye. And item 2 is consideration approving a certified survey map for Michael Faber at Ryan Business Park LLC for the properties at 741 West Ryan, 9600, 9700, 9900 South 13th Street. Carrie?
Okay, this is the final CSM that shows the final configuration of all of the properties that were involved in the previous CSMs discussed. What is on the screen, although very small, but included in your packets, is kind of an overall exhibit showing where all the CSMs are going for all of the properties that are involved. In this CSM, four lots are proposed. Okay, my screen's not working. There it goes. Lot 1 is approximately 16.2 acres, primarily created from Lot 1 of the CSM for 9900 South 13th Street and a portion of 9700 South 13th Street. Lot 2 is approximately 75.4 acres, and that's created from a portion of Lot 1 of the CSM for 9600 South 13th Street, a portion of 9700 South 13th Street, and Lot 2 of the CSM for 9900 South 13th Street. Also, Lot 2 of the CSM for 741 West Ryan Road. This is the large user parcel that was talked about as part of the Ryan Business Park. So this is the parcel that looked like it was going to be landlocked until this CSM brought it all the way out to South 13th Street. So it is not landlocked by the CSM. Lot 3 is approximately 2.6 acres, created from a portion of Lot 1 of the CSM for 9600 South 13th Street. And Lot 4 is approximately 11.9 acres, created from a portion of Lot 1 of the CSM for 9600 South 13th Street. Again, wetlands and floodplain have been delineated and shown. There is that typo for South 13th Street, and the staff concerns that were noted in the report are currently under consideration or have been addressed by the applicant. With the proposed conditions of approval, there is a recommendation that the council adopts the resolution approving the certified survey map. Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Carrie. Questions regarding this last CSM? Greg?
I just have one quick question, and I think maybe you already said this. But Lot 4, that 80-foot notch out over the creek, is what's the reasoning for that? What is it used for there?
That will actually be part of the future right-of-way access. So there's a gap there that will be actually infrastructure and a bridge.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Any? Oh, go ahead.
As a follow-up, is that buildable at all? That's
not buildable, is it? It's part of the 80-foot gap is actually in between the two outlots for the creek. Both those outlots will be retained by Milwaukee County, but the actual gap is part of Lot 1, which is a developable lot. But again, the infrastructure for the road access is all going to be coordinated to make sure that the stream is maintained as much as possible for passage and things like that.
Is there anything going on with the residents directly north that abut this CSMs?
Directly north?
Those are not part of the development. In the sense that they're adjacent to the CSMs, but there will not be any infrastructure that has to cross their properties or anything like that. No. The access is coming from a parcel onto itself that is off of Ryan Road, but it's not part of the CSM, so it's not shown.
Not part of the agenda, but it does abut the CSMs here. Is there any plan moving forward there? Can we talk about that, Melissa, or not?
Right now, it's private property, though.
I understand that.
Yeah. They could actively be marketing. Mike?
My name is Mike Faber with Capstone Quadrangle. We're the developer of Ryan Business Park. 1017W24222 Riverwood Drive, Waukesha. Early in our process of trying to assemble this land, we approached the homeowners in those three residential lots, and they declined to have their parcels considered for inclusion in the business park. There is a stormwater pond immediately to their west along Ryan Road that is was created by the DOT when they rebuilt Ryan Road there, so there's a buffer there to what will be our main entrance coming from the signalized access point further just immediately to the west of that stormwater pond. And those residential parcels, one of them is owned by the seller of 741, the first CSM that we discussed tonight. Their parcels have reached down to well behind those homes to the south branch of the Oak Creek for a long period of time. And so because they declined to have their lots considered as part of the business park, there wasn't anything we could do to include them. They've indicated they intend to continue living in those homes.
Those are the three to the east you're referring to, right?
Correct.
What about the large one to the west?
The large one to the west, same situation. The seller is Mr. Kaler, who owns one of the three lots, and he has said that he intends no development on that. He just wants to keep it permanently.
The biggest one to the west I'm referring to.
To the east, you mean?
To the west.
Empire Millwork?
No, that's Tischendorf.
Oh, we have recently put that parcel, the large one to the west, under contract.
Great, thank you.
Absolutely.
Any other questions? Okay. If not, motion, please.
Yeah, we'll move to approve resolution 11968-080618, approving a certified survey map for Michael Faber, Ryan Business Park LLC, for the properties at 741 West Ryan Road and 9600, 9700, and 9900 South 13th Street.
Kuzakowski, I'll second.
Roll call.
Alderman Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Kuzakowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Item 23 is consideration of an ordinance to amend the boundaries of a designated nature center at 10025 South Shepherd Avenue. Who's got this one?
I can take Andrew? It, I guess. I know Carrie's prepared for this as well in Doug's stead, but I will talk about this because it actually relates to number 25, and I know council's aware of this in reports that you are given on progress in some projects. So this is the first action required to essentially enable the city to partner with the Oak Creek Franklin School District in their Knights construction program. What we had ran up against or kind of discovered, or for the staff that were here in 2008 remembered, right, Mike? there was a designation for this area, you know, as shown in the mapping in the packet, to be a nature center, which, you know, effectively was a council resolution, not a deed restriction or anything more, legalistic or formal than that, to ensure that, you know, development did not take place and potentially roads were not extended through, Oak Lane being the big one out to Shepherd. So with this action, what we're doing is leaving intact the large, vast majority of that nature center. The stormwater pond, which was really the impetus for this piece of ground becoming a nature center, will remain intact. None of that will be impacted by the potential sale of four lots to the north, to the east, along Shepherd Avenue itself, which will be item 25. So just a cleanup item if the council does wish to move forward with the sale of the four lots per item, agenda item 25. Just a cleanup item to make sure that we, touch up this and amend this resolution in this nature center.
Thank you, Andrew. Questions, Greg?
Is this to sell these lots for the Knights construction? Is that what it is?
Exactly.
Exactly.
I should also note too, for both items, we had a lot of discussion in our strategic planning sessions about additional surplus property owned by the city and inventorying all of those types of properties, whether they're buildable or not buildable, for the purposes of removing maintenance responsibility on those. That didn't get into the strategic plan as an action item, but for looking at single-family lot potential an inventory, which was, as you know, as Doug gave and his staff gave a presentation a few council meetings ago, that was a big piece of our strategic plan to meet the demand for single-family lot inventory. So we're kind of addressing an unspoken yet discussed topic of discussion in our strategic plan action items, and then, of course, the two actual strategic action plan goals that are laid out in the memo. So we're kind of checking off some boxes here, if you will.
Danny, I did talk to a few residents in the kind of surrounding areas, South Quail Run and Oak Lane, and also along Shepherd. And generally speaking, as long as there wasn't any actual progress in the past years, you know, there was, you know, big plans at some point to have done a nature conservancy of some sort. They were more worried about the fact that it's become just a weed field and really didn't have any issue here. And
yeah. Good input. No, I mean, the pond's going to remain without a doubt. I mean, there's still officially mapped roads.
Yeah, I mean, the primary concern, I think, for most folks down there is the fact that Oak Lane is staying as a cul-de-sac, and we're not contemplating a through road there, so that would change the dynamic a little bit.
Okay. If no other questions, conversation.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I just want to bring up the fact that I did receive a phone call this afternoon with somebody who is a nearby resident who was concerned about the effect it would have on the remaining prairie. I tried to explain that this was only a portion that was going to be taken out, but just so that the council is aware, there was one concern that was raised.
Any other questions, comments? If none, motion.
It will move to approve ordinance 11973-08061, amending the boundaries of a designated nature center at 10025 South Shepherd Avenue.
Kuzikowski, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Gale.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Tolman.
Aye. Item 24 is consideration of a resolution accepting the vacant land offer to purchase and authorizing closing on the sale of the property, 8159 R South Waring Drive, to Chad and Sarah Johnson. Again, Andrew, who's got it? Melissa? Surplus land.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, surplus land. This is an outlot adjacent to the only residential lot in that area is of the property owners, the proposed buyers here, Chad and Sarah Johnson. So as you saw in your packets, they did approach the city and actually our director of community development and indicated they had a desire to potentially purchase this property. They made an offer. Staff negotiated the agreed upon purchase price of $1,500 for this outlot. The idea would be that this currently tax exempt outlot could be included on the future tax roll. In terms of it, I think this piggybacks exactly in terms of the last matter. Part of the strategic action plan, part of looking at what we're doing with properties within the city, what the purpose is, and moving forward. I think that certainly based upon staff's review of this proposal, it is within the public's best interest to move forward with this transaction. So you had included in your packets a draft proposed offer to purchase, which is already signed by the buyers. If this is approved by the council, the resolution indicates that not only would the mayor and city clerk have the authority to accept the offer and sign on behalf of the city, but also that we could consummate the transaction going through with closing. And as sellers of the property, I would take the lead in making sure that happens and following up after tonight's meeting with the buyers.
All right. Thank you, Melissa. Any questions?
And you probably know, or Mike, you would know too. I couldn't find the actual lot outline on the website, the portal, but you know, do we need to maintain any, or does this lot allow us easements on the creek there over the bridge?
No, we have it. It sits on a curve. This is right in my neighborhood, and this little pie shape is adjacent to the homeowner's lot, and from there out there is nothing but land to the creek, which we retain, which
okay,
is floodplain.
Okay. Yeah, good. I'm in favor of getting rid of this stuff, and it helps landowners mm-hmm. that abut the stuff.
It actually adds to the tax rolls and actually lessens our maintenance.
As long as we have access to, if we have maintenance on that bridge or creek right there.
Yeah, there's plenty of real estate adjacent to that all the way up to the bridge.
Greg?
Just a quick comment. I did speak to the homeowners when they were originally planning this, and same thing, they don't have any immediate plans to build on it. They were already, when they cut their own grass, they would cut into this area to begin with anyways. So now this officially makes them responsible for that area.
No shortage of folks taking care of public land in the city, that's for sure.
If no other questions, motion.
Clerk will move that the Common Council adopt resolution number 11971-080618, accepting the vacant land offer to purchase and authorizing closing on the sale of the property at 8159 R South Waring Drive to Chad and Sarah Johnson.
Dukniak, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Guzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Item 25 is consideration of a resolution accepting the vacant land offer to purchase and authorizing the closing and the sale of the property at 10025 South Shepherd Avenue to the Oak Creek Franklin Joint School District.
I think we teed this one up earlier, but just to, this one's a little more financially impactful to the city, to the good, versus the one we just did. The agreed upon purchase price or sale price based on an appraisal for these four lots is $225,000 to the city. There were some conservative estimates for new tax base that that would be generated by the sale and construction of these, but this is more or as much about the partnership with the school district and making sure the Knights construction curriculum can kind of have an inventory of lots for the next few years. As much as it is about the financial benefits, which are good too. I will say that based, as you saw in the vacant land offer to purchase, there's some due diligence that needs to go on. So as long as those due diligence efforts are, you know, come up, you know, clean or however you want to put that, no issues, we would be positioned to, as in the previous agenda item, convey the property with the clerk and the mayor signing the offer to purchase.
Yeah, questions for Andrew and or Bridget. So the revenues that we derive from the land sales, the 225, nice chunk of change, does that go to the general fund or is that specifically designated for something else?
That's a loaded question. I may have some ideas for it,
but you guys haven't opined. He hasn't given me a decision.
No. Yes, it would be for the general fund. And
that
there
pie
would,
chart?
Yep.
That's other revenues.
There wouldn't be, yeah, there's nothing encumbering the use of this money at this point. It would be just a general fund revenue.
Okay, so there was nothing in the strategic action plan that, you know, called for that money to be used for something?
No.
Okay, thank you.
I think the fire chief ears just perked up a little bit when he heard that.
Steve's are probably ringing too somehow.
Any other questions regarding this sale?
I'll try, right?
If none, motion please.
Gale will move to approve resolution 11972-080618, accepting the vacant land offer to purchase and authorizing the closing on the sale of the property at 10025 South Shepherd Avenue to the Oak Creek Franklin Joint School District.
Kirkowski, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
And item 26 is the license committee. I'd like to turn that over to Alderman Kirkowski.
Thank you, Mayor. I believe everybody has received the Common Council report with regards to the license committee. Does anybody have any questions with what's on that report? Okay, I see none. So Kirkowski will make a motion to adopt the license committee recommendations as listed on the August 6, 2018 license committee report.
Oracle second.
Roll call.
Alderman Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
And item 2017 is consideration of a motion to convene into closed session pursuant to Wisconsin State Statutes, Section 19.85, Parent 1, Parent E, to discuss the proposed finance development agreement by and between the City of Oak Creek and Ryan Business Park, LLC for the properties at 741 and 101 West Ryan Road, and 9600, 9700, and 9900 South 13th Street. President Gale.
Thank you, Mayor. Gale will move to commit in the closed session pursuant to Wisconsin State Statute Section 19.85 sub 1 sub E to discuss a proposed finance development agreement by and between the City of Oak Creek and Ryan Business Park LLC for the properties at 741 and 1001 West Ryan Road and 9600, 9700, and 9900 South 13th Street.
Kuzikowski, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
We'll now convene into closed session, and we will reconvene at its conclusion.
Kuzikowski, second.
Roll call.
Alderman Toman.
Aye.
Gale.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
At this time, we have no motion for action, so call for adjournment.
Kirkowski will make a motion to adjourn.
Lorick will second.
Roll call.
Alderman Gale.
Aye.
Kuzikowski.
Aye.
Kirkowski.
Aye.
Lorick.
Aye.
Dukniak.
Aye.
Toman.
Great. Thank everybody for tuning in. Those of you that streamed us, again, this Saturday, Farmers Market continues, rain or shine. Crops are coming in, so please get out there and enjoy. Thank you.
What about National Night Out?
Tomorrow, that's the reason we're here tonight. We have National Night Out down at the Legion grounds. It starts at
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock. Thank you, Rich. Please get out there, see what our protective services and city services are doing. Be part of the community. Get out there and discover and celebrate Oak Creek. Thanks.